Let us pray. Our Father, we thank you for our coming to the Bible study today. We thank you for your children who are present here. Thank you for the love and interest you have given us to study your word. And we pray, Lord, you'll bless us together as we study the word in Jesus' name, that the word will make us strong, will increase our faith, will draw us closer to you, and will be better Christians as a result of the studies in Jesus' name. Be with us today and let us see the deep, rich things of your word as revealed to us by your Spirit in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord, for the answer. In Jesus' name we pray. We thank the Lord for bringing us to the Bible study today as we are starting a new series in our Bible study. And I really appreciate your coming, and I hope you realize that the study of the Bible is very important for the Christian, especially in our church. It is what develops us for real service unto the Lord. And that's why we go step by step as we look at these studies. We have just finished the epistle to the Hebrews, and now we are starting the general epistle of James. It's very interesting and very instructive as we look at the order and the arrangement of the last 9 books of the New Testament. I mean, as we start from the Hebrews to James to 1 Peter, 2 Peter, 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John, Jude, and Revelation. 9 in all. You will discover something in this group, that there is a careful balance, because Hebrew emphasizes faith. And immediately now it follows with James, which is emphasizing good works, which means believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. There is a new covenant. Enter into the relationship with God in that new covenant by faith. Having been justified and saved by faith, what's it that is going to follow? You will bring forth the evidence that you are abiding in that saving, living faith, and that is good works. And immediately you have James, then you have 1 Peter. And that is stressing future hope. And then 2 Peter is talking about the present growth in grace. Again, you will see as 1 Peter is looking into the future, and he's talking about hope. Immediately after, he brings us to the present, and he says, if you are going to enjoy that hope in the future, there must be growth in grace. And then after 2 Peter, you have the epistles of John. And that is emphasizing love. Isn't that the normal thing to follow? We see the grace of God, coming with the mercy of God, coming with the love of God, and now he's talking about our response to that grace and peace and love and mercy, that we are to love God as well. And I haven't talked about love. Immediately, Jude is following with the fact that we need to contend for the faith once delivered unto the saints. And then Revelation rounds up everything by giving the promise to him that overcometh. The thing you see in that group is that there is a balance. Faith, good works, future hope, present growth in grace, love, contending for the faith, and then promise for the overcomer. It's a lesson to the church that the church should be a balanced church. We should be balanced on the word of God. We are not on this side. We are not on that side. We take the totality of the word of God. Faith is important, but then good works must follow. Future hope is very important. Present growth in grace is also essential. Love is important, but we must not forget contending for the faith once delivered unto the saints. Everything to help us so that we will be overcomers in the final end. And also it means that the preacher too should be balanced. Because without that balance of the preacher will be concentrating just on one thing and will not give the church a balanced teaching of the word of God. And for you as a Christian, it means that your life should be balanced. Your life will not be based just on one thing, just on one area, but your life will be balanced on the totality of the word of God. It also tells us that our conviction in the word of God should be balanced. Balanced in doctrine, balanced in faith, balanced in your hope, balanced in the growth of the grace of God in your life, in love as well as in contending for the faith. As we look at the epistle of James today, we now want to concentrate on the epistle itself. The epistle of James is concentrating on practical life-changing message. There is an obvious emphasis as we look at the epistle of James. You will see that it is not just theoretical. It's not just telling you this is doctrine, this is doctrine. In fact, from the very first chapter, he goes into something practical, talking about Christian living, talking about godly behavior. And he wrote with a passionate desire that all who profess to be saved from sin should be uncompromising in obedience to the word of God. In fact, you'll find that he balances up the difference between what we say and what we do. As you look at the epistle itself as a general introduction, you will see that he's saying, don't be satisfied with just saying, I know the Lord, I'm born again, I'm a child of God. You must balance it up with actually what you do. In James chapter 1 verse 22, look at this. But be ye doers of the word, not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. It's telling us that empty testimony without balancing it up with the life we live will not be appropriate. In chapter 2 and in verse 8, it says, if ye fulfill the royal law according to the scriptures, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself, ye do well. You see the emphasis there, practical Christian living, evidence that you really possess the faith that you are professing. In verse 17, chapter 2, it says, even so faith, if it has not works, is dead, being alone. The emphasis is that faith should not be alone. Testimony should not be alone. Salvation should not be alone. There should be the fruit that we are really born again. In verse 20, he's still saying the same thing. But wilt thou know, O vain man, that faith without works is dead? Verse 26, for as the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without works is dead also. He continues this in chapter 3. Chapter 3 from verse 11. Does a fountain send forth at the same place sweet water and bitter? Can the fig tree, my brethren, bear only berries, either a vine figs? So can no fountain both yield salt water and fresh? You will see the emphasis is calling for something practical, something that will prove that what we say is actually what we're doing. Chapter 4, verse 11. It says, speak not evil of one of another, brethren. He that speaketh evil of his brother and judgeth his brother speaketh evil of the law and judgeth the law. But if thou be a judge of the law, thou art not a doer of the law, but a judge. His emphasis is, it is not just judging, it is not just teaching, it is carrying out the word of God. And he continues like that to the very end. Look at chapter 5. In chapter 5 verse 8, it says, be ye also patient, establish your hearts, for the coming of the Lord draweth near. Grudge not one against another, brethren, lest ye be condemned. Behold, the judge standeth before the door. It's telling us that doing it is very, very important. You see, there are some people that have thought that James contradicted Paul the Apostle, because Paul the Apostle emphasized faith and James is emphasizing good works. But there is no competition, there's no contradiction. Actually, they complement one another. There is a question you're asking when you are talking about the writings of Paul. You're asking, how is salvation received? And the answer is by faith and faith alone. When you come to James, you are not talking about how do we receive salvation. You are saying, how is salvation verified? How do we know that that salvation is really there? And then James is giving us the answer. He says it's by good works. So there is no contradiction. There is a complementary kind of emphasis. Justification is by faith. But then the fruit of righteousness will prove that we have that true faith. We're saved by faith, but were saved unto good works. As we look at the introduction today, we're actually looking at just James chapter 1 verse 1. James chapter 1 verse 1. It says, James, a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes which are scattered abroad, greetings. It may surprise you that we're limiting our study to just that verse 1. It's necessary because there are a lot of things we need to fill in which you don't find in that verse 1 in particular. But you need to understand it so you can have the key to understand the book itself. We're going to divide that verse and the study into three parts. Number one, James the writer. We need to know who the writer is, because as you look at the New Testament, you'll find there are quite a number of people bearing the name James in the New Testament, and you need to know which James actually wrote this. Number two, James is servant of the Redeemer. That's the way he introduces himself. He says, I'm just a servant of God and a servant of the Lord Jesus Christ. And then he's writing to some people, we call them the recipients and the readers, the Jewish recipients and the Christian readers. Let's come back to point number one. In point number one, we're talking about the author. We're talking about the one that was inspired of God to put this down for us. James, a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ. The question is, as a student of the Bible, you'll be asking yourself, which James is this? Because as you look at the New Testament, the name James appears about 40 times in the New Testament. And as you collate and collect together, those 40 occurrences of the name James, they're actually referring to 5 different people. And of the 5 different people, there is one that is very, very popular. That is the one that almost everybody will be able to think about and talk about. That is James, the brother of John, the son of Zebedee, one of the 12 apostles. The other 4 are not well known to most people that read the Bible. Number one, there is one James, and he's called the father of one of the 12 disciples. You'll find that in Luke chapter 6, verse 16. Another James, number 2. This James is the son of Alphaeus, and is one of the 12 himself. And you find him in Matthew chapter 10, verse 3. And you'll find that he's always in the second group of disciples. And then you'll find number 3, the James that is called James the Less. That's in Mark chapter 15, verse 14. All these 3 were not the 3 that wrote the epistle. And there is no argument about among Bible scholars concerning those 3. Everybody accepts, everybody knows that none of those 3 actually wrote the epistle that we're studying today. The question then is, which James? Because it remains true now. The one that is popular, James, the brother of John, the son of Zebedee. Was he the one that wrote this? The answer is no. Because that son of Zebedee, that brother of John, was the first apostle to be martyred. After the matter of, after the killing of Stephen, he was the next one to die among the leaders. You find this in Acts chapter 12. Acts chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. Now, about that time, Herod the king stretched forth his hands to vex certain of the church, and he killed James the brother of John with the sword. Now there is something you also discover. Every time you have the mention of James, it's always linked with his brother John. And in that passage I read to you now, you see it says, James, the brother of John, son of Zebedee. And so he was beheaded. And because of that, he wasn't able to write. He was beheaded very early, A.D. 44. And the epistle we're reading and studying now was written after that A.D. 44. It remains only one James now. And this James, many people are not familiar with. And therefore, we need to look at the scriptures and see this James as the Bible introduces him to us. I need to remind you that Jesus Christ was the firstborn of Mary. not the only child, but the firstborn. Look at Luke chapter 2 verse 7. Luke chapter 2 verse 7. And she brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes. If Jesus were the only son of Mary, the Bible would have said he brought forth a son. His only son. But it says the firstborn. Why was he called the firstborn? Because Mary had other children. And among those other children is this James that we're studying about today. Look at Matthew chapter 13 and verse 55. Matthew 13 verse 55. Is not this the carpenter's son? Is not his mother called Mary and his brethren, plural, his brothers, James, Joseph, Simon, and Judas. And so you find this James, he was the next to the Lord Jesus Christ in that natural line of the family. And as you look at Mark, you have the same thing in Mark chapter 6 verse 3. Still talking about this James in the family among the children of Mary. Mark chapter 6 verse 3. Is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary, the brother of James? You see, they are referring to Jesus, and they called him the carpenter, and they called him the son of Mary, and then they called him the brother of James. Therefore, if Jesus was the brother of James, obviously, James was also the brother of Jesus Christ. But in the natural, when Jesus Christ was still in his earthly ministry, the brethren, James included, did they believe on the Lord Jesus Christ? The answer is no. In John chapter 7 verse 5, John 7 5, it says, for neither did his brethren believe in him. James had not believed when Jesus was still on earth. You will remember now, when Jesus was dying on the cross, what did he do? He told Mary, behold thy son, referring to John, John the beloved, and then told John the beloved, behold thy mother. He wasn't even sure they will take care of the mother, and therefore he handed over Mary to John the beloved. That means that those people, the brethren, they were not believers at that time. How did James come into the faith? 1 Corinthians chapter 15. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, we're reading about the resurrection of Jesus Christ now, reading from verse 4, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the scriptures, and that he was seen of Cephas, and then of the 12, and after that he was seen of above 500 brethren at once, of whom the greater part remaineth until this present, but some are falling asleep. Look at verse 7 in particular. After that he was seen of James, then of all the apostles. Is James that followed him in the family, the son of Mary, the Lord revealed himself to him after his resurrection. Obviously, that led him into the faith. How do we know that that led him into the faith? Because after the ascension of Jesus Christ, we find them now with the apostles, and we find them with the disciples. We find them in the prayer meeting. We find that they had now come into the faith. Acts chapter 1, verse 14. In Acts chapter 1 verse 14, these all continued with one accord in prayer and supplication with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with his brethren. James and Joseph and Judas and Simon, they had now come into the faith because of the appearance of Jesus Christ unto James. And James became a leader in the church. You'll find in Acts chapter 12 that this James became a leader in the church. Acts chapter 12. You see in Acts chapter 12 verses 1 and 2, James, the brother of John, had been killed with the sword. But as you look at verse 17, Peter had come out of the prison now. As he came out of the prison, he appeared, he went into a particular house where the people were praying together. I'm sure you know the story. And now look at what he said, verses 16 and 17. But Peter continued knocking. And when they had opened the door, and saw him, they were astonished. They were surprised because he had been in the prison, but the Lord delivered him. But he, beckoning unto them with the hand to hold their peace, declared unto them how the Lord had brought him out of the prison. Listen to this now. And he said, go show these things unto James and to the brethren. And he departed and went into another place. He must have become a very significant figure in the church. That's why Peter singled him out and he said, James must know about this. He must know of the deliverance that I've got. You tell him in particular, after you have informed him, then you can go and inform the other brethren. In fact, the New Testament refers to him as one of the pillars in the early church. In Galatians chapter 1 verse 19, but other of the apostles saw I none except James, the Lord's brother. You see this? Paul the apostle was saying, I didn't show myself to the other apostles when I came to the Lord, but I revealed myself in particular to James. And he said, you know, the James I'm mentioning is the Lord's brother. And in chapter 2 of Galatians, verse 9, and when James and Cephas and John, who seemed to be pillars, James had become a pillar in the church. We come back to James now, chapter 1. You see, it was this James, the Lord's brother, that wrote the epistle we are reading now. The appearance of the Lord to him after the resurrection changed his life, turned his life around. What a lesson for us. An appearance of the Lord, the single appearance of the Lord to us, can turn our lives around. I pray that the Lord will reveal himself to you. And when you see the Lord, you'll never be the same again in your life, in Jesus' name. Now in James chapter 1, we're going to point number 2. We're looking at James, a servant of the Redeemer. In James chapter 1 verse 1, James, a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus. Now doesn't it surprise you? How would you have expected this man to introduce himself? You would have expected him to say, James, the junior brother of the Lord Jesus Christ. He would have said, James, the son of Mary. I'm talking about the Mary that was the mother of Jesus, because we have the same mother, but not of the same father. And I'm the one writing to you now, and I'm writing to you with the authority of the junior brother of your Savior and our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. He didn't say that. In fact, you realize something. He referred to the Lord Jesus Christ, Lord, 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 many times in this epistle. He was proving and telling everyone, I'm totally submissive to him. I do not count anything about our human relationship. I do not see him in the flesh. I do not know him in the flesh. When I look at him, I look at the glory of God. I look at the grace of God. I look at the fact that he came to give our lives for us, and I never think about the human relationship at all. And this shows his humility, referring to himself as a servant of the Lord. This we find in Jude as well. Look at Jude, that has only one chapter. And this Jude is the Judas that we read about in Matthew chapter 13 and in Mark chapter 6. It says Jude, the servant of Jesus Christ, the brother of James. Do you see both of them? They were very, very careful in saying brother of Jesus Christ, because they knew that Jesus is the Christ. Is the Messiah, is God himself, is the Redeemer, and is the one that is a greater above every human being. If you have been with us there, when we're studying the Hebrews, you will see that it's greater above the angels, it's above the priests, it's above all the high priests, it's even made in the order of Melchizedek. And therefore they were very much afraid to say that we are the brother of Jesus. But Jude said, the servant of Jesus Christ, the brother of James. They refer to themselves without any qualification, any other qualification, just as a servant of the Lord. But in their mind, they didn't see that as something degrading. They didn't see that as something humiliating, because as you look at the Bible, Moses was referred to as a servant of God. Joshua was referred to as a servant of God. Even Caleb was referred to as a servant of God. God, talking about Job, said, he told the devil, "Have you seen my servant Job?" And even Isaiah was referred to as a servant of the Lord. And all the prophets were referred to as the servants of the Lord. Therefore, they chose that title, servant, and they felt that's enough for us. And as you look at other people too in the New Testament, they refer to themselves as a servant of the Lord. And therefore, it was not a degrading title at all. Look at Romans chapter 1, verse 1. And let's see the way that Paul, the apostle himself, the way he referred to himself. Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, separated unto the gospel of God. Here Paul the apostle said, you know what I am? Just a servant of Jesus Christ. Although he added, an apostle of the Lord Jesus Christ. I was saved to give a message unto the church. But Jude did not even bother to say, I'm an apostle, I'm a great worker, I'm having this title. It's simple enough for me to just know I'm a servant of the Lord. In Philippians chapter 1 verse 1, Philippians chapter 1 verse 1, still talking about the servanthood of those who are serving the Lord. Paul and Timotheus, servants of Jesus Christ, to all the saints in Jesus Christ, in Christ Jesus, which are at Philippi, with the bishops and the deacons. Therefore, you will know that to say that they were servants of God was something quite normal. Let's come back to James chapter 1, verse 1. It says, James, a servant. Now, the original word in Greek means a slave. It means somebody that didn't have any choice at all, because he was just simply a servant, a slave of the Lord. And when they refer to themselves as a slave or a bond slave of the Lord, what did that imply? It implied three things. Number one, absolute obedience. Number two, absolute humility. Number three, absolute loyalty. And so when we refer to ourselves as the servants of the Lord, that's the implication. And when James referred to himself as the servant of God and the servant of the Lord Jesus Christ, that's the implication. Number one, it implies absolute obedience. It means that like a slave knows no law except his master's word. It means whatever the Lord says, whatever God himself says, that's the final authority in the life of James. He said, I don't have any personal opinion. I don't have any other thing I'm looking forward to. Just his word. He gives me the word and I obey. He had no rights of his own. He was bound to give his master unquestioning obedience, willing obedience, prompt obedience, total, complete obedience. You know this verse of scripture, but I'll still read it to you in 2 Samuel chapter 15. 2 Samuel chapter 15, verse 15. For us to understand the implication of the use of the word servant. 2 Samuel chapter 15, verse 15. And the king's servant said unto the king, behold, thy servants are ready to do whatsoever my lord the king shall appoint. That's the implication. And we too, we should realize that the Lord has authority over our lives. And we should understand that he is our Lord and we are his servants. And we should give him unqualified, unquestioning, prompt, willing obedience. I said number two, it also talks about humility. And when he said, I'm a servant of Jesus Christ, he was referring to absolute humility. It's the word of a man that does not think of his privileges, of his rights, but of only his duties. He has voluntarily lost himself in the service of the Lord. He must have remembered the words of Jesus Christ. Even though Jesus Christ said those words before he even gave his life to the Lord, he must have known the very importance of humility. Look at Matthew chapter 18 and verse 4. Matthew chapter 18, verse 4.
Whosoever therefore shall humble himself as this little child, the same shall be his greatest in the kingdom of heaven. He must have realized what Jesus said when he was still in his earthly ministry, the importance of humility. In fact, in Matthew chapter 23 and verse 12,
and whosoever shall exalt himself shall be abased, and he that shall humble himself shall be exalted. Humility is so important, and so James said, all I want you to know about me is that I am a servant. It's not even saying, I am the servant, the most important servant. I am the servant, the most exalted servant. I am the servant. I'm an extraordinary special servant. He said, I'm just one of the servants. I am a servant of God, a servant of the Lord Jesus Christ. What idea he is giving here is the idea of humility. I'm not the all in all. I'm not the only one. I'm not the special one. And I'm not even going to claim a special place because I was born by the same mother as the Lord Jesus Christ. Just a servant. In James chapter 4, James chapter 4, verse 6, but he giveth more grace, wherefore he says, God resisteth the proud and giveth grace to the humble. He giveth grace unto the humble. James realized that. That's why all he was concerned about and all he wanted us to know about him is that he was just a servant of the Lord. Number three, I said, it implies absolute loyalty. Complete loyalty. Such a man is saying, I have no interest of my own because all I do and all I want to do is what the Lord has told me to do. He was doing everything for the Lord. He was not going to think of his own profit. He was not going to think of his own preference. His loyalty was completely unto the Lord. And this is the challenge we're receiving, that we too, all our loyalty and all our faithfulness and everything, obedience as well, everything will be unto the Lord. And as we look at the epistle, if we are to have an overview of the epistle, you will see that James, after he had told everybody that I'm just a servant of the Lord, thereafter he kept on referring to Jesus Christ as his Lord, and of course referred to the Heavenly Father too as Lord, because he said, I'm a servant of God, therefore God is my Lord. I'm a servant of Jesus Christ, therefore he is my Lord. I want you to see this Lordship of Christ and the Lordship and the control of God over his life, how it was prominent and preeminent in his life. Look at James chapter 1 verse 7. James chapter 1, verse 7, it says, for let not that man think that he will receive anything of the Lord. Referring to Jesus Christ, referring to God, is instead of saying God, instead of saying the Father, most of the time he just refers to them as Lord, having total control over his life. In chapter 1, verse 12, blessed is the man that endureth temptation, for when he is tried, he shall receive the crown of life which the Lord has promised to them that love him. You see his concern. I am servant, he is Lord. I am servant, he is Lord. I'm a bond slave, he is Lord. In chapter 2 and in verse 1, my brethren, have not the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ. He wants to remind you, he wants to remind us, he is Lord every time. He didn't put it as a sticker, he didn't put it as a poster, but just he had the idea within, he had the submission within, he had the loyalty within, he had the total obedience within, he is my Lord. In chapter 4 verse 10, humble yourselves therefore in the sight of the Lord, and he shall lift you up. And in verse 15, for that he ought to say, if the Lord will, we shall live and do this or do that. He said, you will not even think of tomorrow without thinking of the Lord. You will not plan anything, I will do this, I will go here. You must make sure that your life is totally submissive under the Lordship and the control and the authority of the Lord. In chapter 5 verse 7, it says, be patient therefore, brethren, unto the coming of, he could have said of Jesus Christ, he could have said of our Savior, but you know, his attitude is just that I'm a servant, he is Lord, of the coming, the appearance of the Lord. And then in verse 8, be ye also patient, establish your heart, for the coming of, you know, you could have mentioned the coming of our Redeemer, the coming of our Savior. He wants to emphasize the fact that he is Lord. He said, be patient, let him establish your heart, for the coming of the Lord draweth near. And chapter 5 verse 10, take my brethren, the prophets, who have spoken in the name of the Lord, for an example of suffering and of patience. And in verse 14, is any sick among you, let him call for the elders of the church, and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. In verse 15, and the prayer of faith shall save the sick, and the Lord shall raise him up. There is one thing you learn very obviously, that the Lordship of Christ was very conspicuous and very prominent in the life of this man. It was there in his language, it was there in his attitude, it was there in his plans, in his desires, in everything. Totally submissive. I'm a servant of God, I'm a servant of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I pray that that same attitude will be in every one of us in Jesus' name. Now we come back to James chapter 1. James chapter 1. James, which James is this, we have learned now, is a brother of Jesus Christ. And then a servant of God and a servant of the Lord Jesus. What's the implication of that? It's the implication of humility. It's the implication of obedience. It's the implication of loyalty. Who was he now writing to? Who were the recipients of the epistle? To the 12 tribes which are scattered abroad, greetings. He was writing to the Jewish people who had been scattered abroad. Why were they scattered abroad? Now, first of all, please understand, when he mentions the 12 tribes, that's a way of referring to the Israelites. Do you remember sometimes when Jesus Christ was talking, when he said, you that have followed me in this generation, you will rule over the 12 tribes of Israel. Since the nation of Israel are 12 tribes, sometimes they'll be called Israel, just as a nation. At other times, they'll be called directly just the 12 tribes. And so when he mentioned the 12 tribes, he was referring to the Jewish people. And what did he mean when he said they scattered, the 12 tribes which are scattered? Look at John, the gospel according to St. John, chapter 7 and verse 35. Even before the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, there have been kind of two deportations, that the children of Israel have been deported away from their land, and they have been dispersed and sent away from their land. And some of them came back, and some of them were still outside there. And so whenever you refer to the 12 tribes that are scattered, you could be referring to those people. Let me remind you now of the story of the day of Pentecost. Do you remember, on the day of Pentecost, we are told that there were many Jewish people there. But those Jewish people, when they heard them speaking in tongues, they said, what? How are these people speaking in the languages of the place where we were born? They were Jewish people, but they were scattered abroad. And during the time of the Feast of Pentecost, they came over there. And after the Feast of Pentecost was over, many of them went back again. But those people, they need to continue in their faith. That's why he needed to write unto them now, the people that were scattered abroad. But also apart from that, the people that have believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, 3,000 on the day of Pentecost, 5,000 another time. And then in Acts chapter 6, a multitude of the people that believed. They were very, very many now. At the time of the persecution of Stephen, when he was martyred, when he was killed, there was so great persecution. And then the church was scattered. All those people that were scattered, they knew the Lord, they believed in the Lord, they were children of God, but they needed encouragement, they needed instruction, they needed to know that although they were suffering, they shouldn't count their suffering as anything. The Lord will be coming back to take them back home. I've already told you how they are referred to as the scattered Jews. Let me read the references to you now. In John chapter 7 and in verse 35, then Then said the Jews among themselves, whither will he go, that we shall not find him? Will he go unto the dispersed among the Gentiles and teach the Gentiles? Is he going to go to the people that are scattered abroad, the people that have gone to those different places? Then look at Acts of the Apostles chapter 8. Acts of the Apostles chapter 8 verse 1. And Saul was consenting unto his death. And at that time, there was a great persecution against the church, which was at Jerusalem. And they were all scattered abroad throughout the regions of Judea and Samaria, except the apostles. Thousands of the believers, literally thousands, all of them were scattered away from Jerusalem. And these people, they needed the word of God. And James must have remembered the words of Amos. Because in Amos, look at Amos chapter 8, we're looking at verses 11 and 12. James must have remembered that as they were scattered abroad, all the apostles were over here in Jerusalem, all the preachers were over here in Palestine, and these people did not have apostles with them, they didn't have prophets with them, they didn't have the evangelists and the pastors and the teachers with them. They needed encouragement and instruction, and they needed the word of the Lord so that they'll be able to continue in the faith. He must have remembered Amos chapter 8 verse 11. Behold, the days come, says the Lord God, that I will send a famine in the land, not a famine of bread nor a thirst for water, but of hearing the words of the Lord. And they shall wander from sea to sea, and from the north even to the east, and they shall run to and fro to seek the word of the Lord, and they shall not find it. And therefore he had concern for them. As these people are there, they needed the word of God so they will be able to grow. They needed the word of God so that they will be moving on in their faith. They needed the word of God so that they will increase in their faith. They needed the word of God so they will be steadfast. They continue steadfast in the apostles' doctrine. That was in Jerusalem, but now they have scattered them. How will they continue now? It is because of that he was writing unto them. He said, to the 12 tribes which are scattered abroad. And these people that were scattered abroad, they had already started forming little assemblies wherever they went. But remember, the Bible had not been printed, and they didn't have a copy of the Bible in their hand, so they will just meet together. Maybe they will sing, maybe they will pray. And even the Old Testament that was completed, none of them had the copies of the Old Testament with them. They needed the word of God. How do we know they were already having assemblies where they were meeting together and worshiping together? Look at chapter 2, James chapter 2 verse 1. It says, my brethren, have not the faith of our Lord Jesus, the Lord of glory, with respect of persons. Verse 2, for if there come unto your assembly a man with a gold ring, an unbeliever coming in, but gorgeously dressed and in goodly apparel, and there come in also a poor man in vile raiment. One thing is clear here, they already have in assemblies, and he was writing to them, in your assemblies you don't have the word of God to read. And I need to tell you this, that the word of God is very important for you. That's why he was sending the word of God unto them. Not only that, he knew that as a result of the persecution, of the scattering, you understand, they sent them away from their homes, they lost their property, and they lost their job, and some of the families were scattered, and some of them, they might be so discouraged now, say, what is all this? Why are we suffering like this? But we have believed on the Lord Jesus Christ. Should it not be better for us than when we were unbelievers? If it is like this, maybe we should give up the faith. Some of them were backsliding already. That's why he said in chapter 5 and verse 19, verse 20, brethren, if any of you do err from the truth and one convert him, let him know that he which converted the sinner from the error of his way shall save his soul from death and shall hide a multitude of sins. Because they were scattered abroad, and there was no pastor, there was no teacher, no apostle overseeing them and encouraging them, some were backsliding. That's the reason he needed to write unto them. Not only that, there were some of them, the things they knew when they were in Jerusalem, the word of God they knew before, they were not practicing them anymore. Because the encouragement of the warmth of faith, the warmth of fellowship, all that was disappearing now. That's why he wrote to them in chapter 4 verse 17, therefore, to him him that knoweth to do good. All that you learnt when you were in Jerusalem, all that you learnt when you were together, before you were scattered abroad, to him that knoweth to do good and doeth it not, to him it is sin. You understand now the reason why he wrote to them? He wrote to them so that they could be encouraged. And he was writing to them as brethren. In fact, sometimes they call them beloved brethren. The persecution that scattered them, what was the purpose of the devil? The devil thought he will destroy the church. He will destroy the gospel. But the Lord used that to even spread the gospel and to evangelize the world. Maybe you are suffering persecution too. Maybe sometimes you are in a place where you are not here and you cannot hear the word of God regularly. Understand that you must still continue to grow. You must still take the word of God. Because of the grace of God, now we have the Bible. You can read the Bible. The Lord has so made it. We even have cases we can listen to. You even have the past outlines of the Bible study. You can go over and over and over again, so that no matter where you are, the outlines are there, the cassettes are there, the Bible is there. You should still be able to hold on. You will hold on in Jesus' name. What was the primary concern of James? The primary concern of James were those believers outside Palestine, Jews and Gentiles now, because as they had gone out, they had influenced some of the Gentiles too to believe on the word of God, so that those people outside Palestine, they will live a life of righteousness, which will be a proof of genuine salvation, evidence of the living faith they had in the Lord. Today we've seen the introduction. Number one, we've seen James was the writer. And this James, although he was related to the Lord Jesus Christ, he had the greatest respect for the Lord Jesus Christ. All he was going to think about is, I'm a servant of the Lord. Maybe you are related to a region overseer, a state overseer. Maybe you are there and your husband happens to be the coordinator in your district. When he talks, I hope you'll forget, the human relationship. You'll forget, oh, that's my senior brother. You'll forget, I know him very much. You will understand the word of God is very important, and you will take that word of God like James and just say, I'm just a servant of the Lord, a servant of God as well. And then when our brethren have gone on holidays, or they have gone on transfer, or they have gone somewhere, there will be people among us that will be concerned about them. We'll send tracts to them, we'll send books to them, we'll send cassettes to them, we'll send spiritual materials to them, so that as they are scattered abroad, if the trumpet sounds before they come back, we who are the headquarters, they who are scattered abroad, will all be raptured, will meet together at the feet of Jesus in Jesus' name. So that wherever you are, although we may not see your face, we may not see you face to face like this, when the trumpet shall sound, we shall be together in Jesus' name. We'll rise up and take what we have learned today, we'll take it to the Lord. Are you as humble as James? Are you as lowly, as meek, as submissive as James? Are you submissive to the authority of the Lord, and you refer to yourself as a born slave of the Lord? I'm a prisoner of love. Are you a prisoner of love, the love of the Lord, that he will control you, he will supervise your life, and you give yourself totally to the Lord? I'm just a born slave of the Lord. Open your mouth and talk to the Lord. Talk to the Lord. Are you obedient to the Lord? Are you loyal to the Lord? Are you humble before the Lord? Do you really show that humility that shall characterize a child of God? Let him do it in you what he did in James. If he did so much in James, that James will not even mention the human relationship. I think we shall allow the grace of God in our lives, so the humility will be there, the loyalty will be there, the obedience will be there. And when some of the believers are outside the headquarters and they are in a place they cannot hear the word of God directly, I hope you'll send the outlines to them. I hope you'll send the cassettes to them. I hope you'll send the messages to them. I hope you'll be helping them to keep on growing in their faith. And if you happen to go to a place you cannot hear the word of God directly, as we are doing here, I hope you'll take the outlines with you. And I hope you'll keep on reading the word of God, because it is that through word of God, you'll be established and be firm in your faith until the very end. that whenever the Lord will come, whether we are here together or we are scattered abroad, we'll hear the trumpet sound and we'll be with the Lord on the final day.